So a very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you again for coming to the Global Entrepreneurship class. Today we are having an external speaker to speak to us. She attended one of our classes before, and today is her turn to speak to you. So let me just quickly introduce Datin Dr. Shahira. She represents the country at international conferences on entrepreneurship and innovation. She's a frequent speaker and a judge in many national events on entrepreneurship. And she has co-authored books on entrepreneurship, and she leads teams on design of new programs in entrepreneurship and education. Her opinion has been sought by other ministries and agencies in entrepreneurship development because of her key role at the Ministry of Education in this field. She also writes ministerial speeches on entrepreneurship. Dr. Shahira holds a PhD in entrepreneurship from Massey University in New Zealand, and her work has been cited by academics from all over the world. She holds an MBA in international business, first class from University Putra, Malaysia, and a BE Commerce from Queen's University in Canada. She's currently on several boards and councils and committees related to higher education. Our paths actually crossed because we are both interested in developing entrepreneurial graduate, and she's currently heading the entrepreneurship unit at the Ministry of Education. So she's going to speak to us about her experience, her expectations, and she told me most importantly, she would like actually to seek some feedback from not only the students who are here on campus, but the online students from more than 131 different countries, to if there are anything that they could share with her on how she can help the ministry and the country in developing more entrepreneurial graduates. So without further ado, I would like you to join me to welcome Datin Dr. Shahira. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you so much, Prof. Mushtaq. Actually, I'm quite nervous today. Two reasons, Prof. Mushtaq. One is I was wired all over the body. Sure. This is the first time I feel. Secondly, because I think it is quite rare for me to be in a classroom where the majority are boys. Most of places I go, the majority, three quarter of the class would usually be girls. So I feel so glad because at least my daughter can find a good man to be married to in the future. Because we are always asking ourselves, where are our boys, you know, because they are not in institutions of higher learning, so where they are. Because in terms of populations, we know that Malaysian population, there are more boys than girls. But when I go to public higher education institutions, there were always more girls than boys. So good, Prof. Mushtaq, you have good boys here. So thank you so much for your kind introduction. So as Prof. Mushtaq has briefly introduced why actually I'm here, I would also like to thank Prof. Mushtaq for giving me an opportunity to be here, because I would very much engage with students, and usually I got an opportunity to engage with students from public universities. I think this is only the third time I had an opportunity to engage with private university students. So thank you so much. So what I will, with the time that I have, I will share with all of you in terms of what is it that our aspirations as a country, and where we want to bring our country to be. And of course, I will also share with you guys the challenges of the 21st century, and of course, the challenges to you. I think most of you are in second year or third year? Second or third year. So in a year time or 2 years time, you'll be out there in the real world. So I will also share some of the challenges that will be waiting for you the moment you step up from Taylor's universities. And towards the end, as a government, you always know that governments come up with policy. At the moment, I would share with you the policy that we have. And as Prof. Mushtaq has explained, we are in the process of trying to review the policy and to make the policy more meaningful and more effective for us to produce what we call entrepreneurial graduates of the 21st century. So I would spare, I think, some time to get a feedback and input from you guys. Okay. Some of you are Malaysians, right? But the question is, do you know where we want to be as a country? Where Malaysia wants to be as a country?
First world country?
Yeah, first world country, but more specifically. Anyone, come on. Okay, as a country, Malaysia wants to be a developed nation by the year 2020. When the former Prime Minister Tun Mahathir announced that Vision 2020, it was like in 1990s. At that time, I'm still young. I'm still at primary school. So I was telling myself, what is it that Tun Mahathir is talking about? 2020 is so far away. But, you know, time flies so fast. It is now 2014. It is in April. So we only have about three quarter years to go to 2020, right? So, but what kind of developed nation that we want Malaysia to be in 2020? That's another question. Yes.
And, since it's there, high income nation, the citizens earn at least mid targeted income, sustainable development.
And the last point. Inclusivity.
Inclusivity, I'm not really sure what that means.
Okay,
in this context.
See, he's very honest, thank you. We would like to be high income nation. What does it mean by high income nation? Don't feel bad, because there are so many other events that when I ask students, what do you understand, what does high income mean? Everybody was like, no, we just know that because a lot of people are saying it, so we know that it's high income. What it means is that by 2020, we would like to see, on average, every Malaysian can earn about ringgit Malaysia 5,000 a month. At the moment, our monthly income on average is about 3,300 ringgit a month. So for us to have a comfortable life, we need more than that. 3,000, what can you buy in 3,000? Can you survive 3,000 a month?
Well, if living in...
If you're living, not living in, with your parents.
No, I mean, if you're living in a city, it's a bit difficult.
Yes, it's a bit difficult. Okay. And of course, we want to be it to be inclusive, meaning that we learn from some developed nation where when the nation become a high income or developed nation, majority of the population is poor. You know, in the United States, they said 1% versus 99%. Only 1% of the wealth of the country, the wealth of the country is being controlled by only 1% of the population, whereas the 99% is struggling. So we don't want that to happen to Malaysia. And of course, we want it to be sustainable. So I hope by now, if people ask you, do you know what is high income country? Again. No, it's okay. Meaning that we would like to see that per capita income by 2020 is about $15,000 USD to $20,000 USD. That is in terms of what we want to be as a country. We also like to see Malaysia to be different in terms of, because we have different culture, we have different environments, we have different situations in Malaysia. So what we like Malaysia to be is market-led, well-governed, regionally integrated, enterprising and innovative nation. The enterprising and innovative nation is very important, because that is the, people always say that entrepreneurship is the driver for innovation, is the driver for economic growth. I will not go into detail because I think it must have covered in some of your lectures in this global entrepreneurship. Okay, we are now living in 21st century, right? You know what does economists call 21st century? It's okay. What do you think they call 21st century?
No idea.
They call it crazy century.
Crazy.
You know why? Because things are so crazy. If you look at the things that happening now, you might not think that it will happen now. You know, long time ago, we always talk about, you know, like, even now, if you ask me, people are confused which one is ghost, which one is human. Because maybe the two of them act like the same. You know? And we have situation where during the day, you are
sleeping.
3 o'clock, you wake up. You know, lucky that I got your sessions at 2:30. If I get a session at 9, most of them are still sleeping.
No, no, this group, these are very alert people.
Oh, thank you. I suggest that maybe, you know, to get more attention, you should give me a time at 3 a.m. in the morning. So most of you are actively, you know, doing something. Okay. We are in terms of economics, you know, we are shifting from services, knowledge-based, to innovative economies. And of course now, globalization, world without boundaries, technology is fast changing. Whatever that you learn today may not be relevant the time that you graduate, or may not be relevant even the next month. So those of you who are taking engineering and things like that, you must ensure that you keep update on the technology. For example, phones technology, you know, now it's already what, Samsung X5, iPhone X1. I just learned how to use Facebook, and my daughter said Facebook is outdated. You know, so I don't know how can I chase the technology. So I would just live day by day. And then higher rates of products, technological advancement, adolescence, greater opportunities for travel and migration. I'm sure none of you in this class has not been traveling outside KL. Definitely, most of you have been out from Malaysia, right? Anybody has not been out from Malaysia? See, everybody has been out in Malaysia. Everyone can fly. Although now, you know, like people are a bit dangerous and cannot take ship, so walk lah. And maybe riding a horse is more must safer. And of course, with the emerging economies, we are facing with societal challenges. One is that increasing cost of livings. As Andrew has said, you know, if you are living in an urban area, you 3,000 may not be enough. I think about 10 years back in Malaysia, there's no such words as homeless people in Malaysia, right? But at the moment, if you take the ERL and you see under the bridge, you can see homeless people. And you can see that these homeless people, sometime when they sleep at the stairs or things like that, they are wearing ties. So they are not like, you know, like a beggar, but they cannot afford a good homes. And that is one thing. That's why I always talk to students, you know, especially the final year students, I ask them, anyone of you here, you know, like the moment you graduate, you're thinking about getting married. Anyone here? So good like your student never think getting married.
They never think of what?
Getting married after graduation.
I think he's thinking.
You're thinking, right? I want to give you the sister brother advice. You think when you got married, of course you're young, and then something happened at night and you have kids. And since you're young, you're still strong, rather than have one child, you have triplets. So I want to ask you, what are the two things that will consume your salary if you have a child or three children, three babies? Two things that you must buy.
Food.
Yeah, baby doesn't eat yet. So milk, right? And what else? Yes. Diapers. Oh, you have experience. So two things that you must buy as a father: milk, baby formula, and diapers. If you had a chance, when you go to shopping mall, don't just see the gadgets and things like that. Go to the baby section. Look at how much it costs you for a small tin of baby formula.
Oh God, the SC one very
100.
Yes. He must have experience, you know. You're very good. 100 something, right? Cannot be divorced so young. Okay, that one small thing is about 100 ringgit. Diapers. How much is diapers?
Diapers cheaper.
40 to 50.
Yeah, about that. 50 to 40. Okay. And one thing, if you have triplets and all are boys, because boy drinks a lot as compared to girls, you know, it will only finish in 2 days, I think. If triplets.
That and these people won't get married after this.
Okay. Anyway, does it enough for you to have a very low salary if you want to have a good life? That is the point. And the increasing cost of living. Right? So you have to think about that. Okay. Secondly, we are living in a very diverse ethnicity and populations. Before, in 1969, we had problems in terms of the unity among races. And then it's been okay for a while, but now it's getting back as a problems. Okay, I don't want to go into detail because that will need a different session. Widening gap between the rich and the poor. You are lucky because you are here. Because you have parents who can afford to send you here to study. But since middle 1990s, you know, the gap between the rich and the poor in Malaysia has widened quite a lot. So that is not good. We're saying that we want to be a developed nation where everything is inclusive. So if we didn't tackle that problems where there is one person who have a big house with 25 rooms and we have another family who lives in a very poor conditions of house. So we don't want that to happen in Malaysia. Again, since 2008, there is an economic recession. Although there are some improvements, but still, global economy outlook still remains uncertain. This is very much relevant to you because in 2 or 3 years' time, you'll be out there. So there will be challenges waiting for you once the economic situation is not that strong. And since early 1990s, the capacity of world economy to create jobs has been declining. That will bring me to the next point later on. And labour markets are plagued with low or negative wage growth that is impacting predominantly on wage earners at the lower end. Meaning that if you enter the workplace, usually you will start at the middle, right? You will not start on the top unless you become entrepreneurs or you create your own organisation. Then you can become entrepreneurs. So the rising salary between CEOs and people at the bottom is not going, you know, the CEO salary has been jumping quite a lot, whereas the bottom has been very steadily, or sometimes it's not even moving up. Okay, enough about the world. What about you? Now we are talking about you. The challenges that you will be facing when you become graduates, especially when during the first 2-3 years when you finish your studies. First is that you'll be facing with competitive labour market. The report released by International Labour Organization in 2013, I think about 73 million young people are unemployed. Okay? And young people are 3 times more likely than adults to be unemployed because you don't have experience. Unless you have experience, that's why we encourage you to gain as much experience once you are in the universities. Okay? And graduates are also finding it tough to get suitable jobs. In Malaysia, unemployment rate is very low. It's about 2.8%. So we can say that it is full employment. That's why we have millions of foreign workers in Malaysia. So if graduates can just grab any jobs, you will find jobs, right? But the question is whether will you get the job that can match your qualification? You graduate as an engineering graduate. Will you become an engineer? You graduate with an accountant degree. Will you become an accountant? Or will you be a cashier at McDonald's? I have officers in my office. One has master's degrees. Two has first undergraduate degrees. And the three of them are actually working clerical work. So you can see that that is now the reality in our country. And of course, yeah, another issue that we are facing is that, oh, you can see that employers, they always say that, oh, local graduates are not good. Taylor's graduate are not good as compared to graduates from United States. Is that true or not? It may not be true, but it is some perceptions among some employees. So what I'm always advise people, although it may not be true, but when it is perceptions, for example, if people keep saying in the social media that you are, what, your name please?
Muhammad.
You are actually not Muhammad. You are actually a girl. You know, and go viral. It is not true. You see, obviously he's a man. But if there are so many, many people talking, even he will see, he asked the mother, am I a girl or am I a boy actually when I was born? Right? So you need to face that there will always be perception which is not correct. But you have to live with that and how for you to overcome that perception. Sometime in last year, in August, I think these articles came out in the Star. It says that 35% drop in job vacancies and seekers, especially fresh graduates, are competing for fewer openings. There are a few reasons that they give. One is that now the retirement age in Malaysia has been increased from 55 to 60. So you would expect that that person was supposed to retire, he will occupy that position for another 5 years. Secondly, because the economic situation is still not that strong, companies are being very careful to make the new hiring. Rather than they make new hiring, they will say that, okay, Muhammad, since you are doing accounting now, so I want you to also do human resource. You know, rather than I employ another graduates, new graduates, do the human resource. So they're a bit careful in terms of that. And there is a tendency, and they will also like to opt for contract employees rather than permanent employees. Because permanent employees, you have to provide so many things. You have to buy training, you have to buy all these car loans or whatever that, but contract employees is so easy, okay? There is a tendency that if you don't get jobs, you further your study. Right? You do masters. But it does not guarantee that you will get job after you finish your postgraduate studies. So even postgraduates are finding it more and more difficult to find jobs that match your qualification. Especially those of you who like to straight away continue your study. Because still then people will say that this job is too overqualified for you. Or they say, yeah, you have masters, so what? You don't have the experience that we need. So that are the situations now in Malaysia. When I asked just now whether is that true that your quality is not good, you said that it is not true. Yeah, I believe that you are all good, that's why you are in this class. But these are the study done by Malaysian Employers Federations. Okay? They said that we have problems when we want to hire fresh graduates. And the top problem, which I don't think is an issue here, is a poor command of English. I know all of you here are lucky that you can speak English very well. But the question is still, can you communicate effectively? Every one of you have phones, right? If you don't have phone, you are actually Flintstone. Okay, you are not human, you are aliens if you don't have handphones. Smartphones especially. Okay, do you notice that when you write in your phones, you have your phone, right? Can you share with me the last post, whatever, that you sent to your friend? Not to your girlfriends, lah.
Yeah, sure. It's an open landing, actually. I said hello, and the guy didn't reply.
Huh?
Last thing he said was hello.
Hello?
Yeah. Is it me you're looking for?
No.
Is that hello to him? Now you know she a girl or boy? different one.
Yeah.
Is there any thing? Okay.
I'm joining Facebook.
Okay.
Nothing, no reply also. No one likes me.
Okay, how do you write? Where are we going to meet tonight? Spell it for me.
W-H-E-R-E.
No, don't spell it in English. The way that you spell it. Is that how you spell in when you're texting to your friends?
Where are you going?
No, he's so good.
Is he? Yeah, no, because of you. Jeff is with the short hand.
I don't use short hand. I type two
ones. Oh, so good, huh? Okay, usually this is how people write.
Okay, let's see how that in writes it.
Not me. Right? Most people will write like that.
I used to use this, then I stopped.
It's too nice. So usually people will write W-H-E for where. R is R. We, how do you spell it? So can you imagine if a person like me want to read your message? You know how does it works like? Right? So you're talking like an alien. In writing. You know why? Why? Do you know why I raised this? Because my young officers writing an official email to a very important person using that kind of language. So when you go out there, you have to differentiate between is it the language of your friends or is it the language of, you know, like, and then sometimes you use like come. Instead of C-O-M-E, you put C-U-M. Do you know what C-U-M means? Huh. You see, can you write to your like vice chancellors, you know, like, can you come tonight? C-U-M.
Go get it.
Oh, you didn't know? Oh my
God. Go get it.
Later. English course. Poor character, attitude, or personality. Okay? So the employees are saying the young generation are always on Facebook, always on social media, they don't do their work. And then they come, they sleep, and then 3 o'clock they want to come to office. You know, things like that, poor character. And then asking for unrealistic salary or benefits. And mismatch of skills, that's why I'm saying that you are studying something else and you are asking something else. Because maybe the things that you study, you may not find that there is a job openings, you know. And choosy in jobs or company. Okay, and so on, just to share. Okay, this is not my house, this is my office. Okay, so the Ministry of Education is accountable to provide with the country the human capital of the country. For us to be a good nation, we need to have a good human capital, a competitive human capital that can help the country to move forward, right? And you are the human capital that we are looking at. You know, we don't look at people who are racing down there, didn't do anything, it's a lepak. We will always need to depend on people, who the young people who are in universities.
I think this lecture is also for the students who are not from Malaysia. So maybe you would like to say what's lepak.
Oh, lepak is just like
hang around,
lazing around,
chilling.
What else? Walking, doing nothing, sending text message, enjoy life as it will not end forever. Money will always keep coming. My parents will always pay for me, you know, that kind of thing. Smoke there, smoke there. So when we are looking at all the challenges that are now happening around the world, as well as in Malaysia, we're thinking that what is the best way or effective way that we can prepare our young people? You know, because we cannot keep saying to you, I know like Taylor's University is very good in terms of trying to find job for you, to make sure that you have jobs because your parents paid that you make sure you have a job. If not, I'm not registered my son in Taylor's. But how can we promise you something which is uncertain? We cannot always make things certain for you. So the best that a parents or what we can do is that we can help you prepare yourself for the uncertainty. Because in life, there will always be uncertainty. So one of the ways that when we look at what happens in other countries, one of the mechanisms that they use is through entrepreneurship education. Meaning that we try to inculcate entrepreneurship values and attributes in the education system. So in 2010, the ministry has launched the policy, we call it Entrepreneurship Development Policy for Institutions of Higher Learning. We know that universities do some entrepreneurship activities here and there, but it's not holistic. You know, we want it to be holistic. So this policy is actually to encourage universities to be more enterprising in their way of teaching their students, so that their students are more prepared to face the real and the real world, which is more, which is competitive and very uncertain. And of course, the three main objectives of the policy, don't get confused when we talk about entrepreneurship. The first thing that comes to many people's mind is that, oh, we want people to be in business, right? So we know that not all of you can be a businessman. Because for you to be a businessman or for you to be entrepreneurs, you need to have certain characteristics and certain passion into what you are trying to do. So, but if you look at successful entrepreneurs, what are the characteristics that they share? They can communicate very well, right? They can convince you, rather than you don't want to buy, you end up buying things. Okay. Second, they are very resilient, perseverance. And they see problems as opportunities. And they are very competitive, and they not easily give up, you know. They don't cry if they cannot sell something. Even they cry, but, you know, like they went bankrupt and then they come up again. When bankrupts come up again. So if we can instill that characteristic and mindset of that successful entrepreneur in each one of you, we can at least say to ourselves, we have prepared you to face the jungle out there. You know, that is the first objective, to produce graduates with entrepreneurial mindsets and capabilities. The second objective, we know that we need more and more young people to create your own opportunities. When I say own opportunities, either you set up your enterprise, it can be business enterprise, it can be social enterprise, you set up your own startup, you set up your own opportunities, and you become a job creator to graduates, you know. So we need more and more of you become what we call graduate entrepreneurs. And of course, for us to achieve that first two objectives, we need the academics who are also have enterprising mindset. Okay. For us to ensure that the policy achieve the three objectives, we come up with strategy action plan. So now if you know, like, this is the way that how governments come up into a policy, and then they come up, policy is just a general guideline, and then they have a specific plan on how to achieve all the objectives under that policy. So under this strategic plan, we have strategies, and we have initiative, and of course each initiative we have what we call key performance indicator. Okay, come to the policy thing. I think when I was in school, I also don't understand what policy, but I did take a public policy study after that, just to familiarize myself. What it means that strict strategic trust is that these are the trust that we would like to pay attention to for us to have an environment where you can develop your personal entrepreneurial development. The first is to strengthen. Okay, when we come up with the policy, it was in 2010, and then we did some review: what is good, what is not bad, what is working, what is not working. Now we come up with action plan. And now it's in 2014, as Prof. Mushtaq has announced just now, we are also reviewing on how we can move forward in terms of entrepreneurship developments. I don't think I will go in detail for every trust. For example, Trust 1, Strengthening Entrepreneurship Center in Institutions of Higher Learning. I'm not sure whether Taylors have the center or not.
We don't have, but you just tell them this is going to be in the exam.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And then, provide a plan and holistic entrepreneurship education and programs. This is what I'm saying, that when we approach universities, you know, the first thing that people have, oh, this is the jobs of School of Business, you know, meaning that we are talking about entrepreneurship, meaning that you have School of Business has to offer courses in marketing, in financial management, in how to do your taxation, etc. But that is not really it. If we want every one of you to be exposed to entrepreneurship elements, it has to be cut across the curriculum. Doesn't matter whether you take engineering, doesn't matter whether you take science, whether you take physics, or whether you want to become a doctor or dentist, you must, we would like to see that each one of you have opportunity to learn about entrepreneurship, you know. And we would like to strengthen the trust number three, strengthening entrepreneurship development and consolidation program. We understand there are a small minority of students who actually has a passion to become entrepreneurs, but they do need support. So we are looking into people that what kind of support that the universities can actually hand to these students to ensure that your dream to become entrepreneurs is being realized in the future. And strengthening the competency of educators and mentors, providing a conducive environment and ecosystem for entrepreneurship development, and improve the effectiveness of the implementation. These are the main initiatives that has been undertaken by the ministry for since the launching of the policy. First, for public universities, they have every public university students must take entrepreneurship foundation module. It's compulsory. If they don't take that, they cannot graduate. So, but the input that we get from students, it is so theoretical. They said that they just don't want to know, but they want to do it, you know, action. So we said that we have improved that. We put in some more practical elements in that module. And we have also recognized that if you do some kind of entrepreneurship activities, co-curriculum activities, it can be credited. So in public universities, most of the universities has acknowledged that, okay, if you do kind of like selling and things like that, but it's very structured, you can get credit for that. And awareness and enculturation programs. Awareness meaning that what is entrepreneurship, you know? So universities needs to actually expose students to what does it means by entrepreneurship. Like if you take this course, definitely in the first session, Prof. Mushtaq has also explained what is entrepreneurship is all about. And we have entrepreneurship and business idea competition. This one actually, when we run the competition, we always work with the industry players, because they are the one who help the ministry to have the competition. Structured entrepreneurship program. Okay, one area which many people didn't know is social entrepreneurship activities. You know, like young people always shout out there, we want to make a difference. We want to help up society. But how can you make a difference in a very sustainable manner? Social entrepreneurship. What social entrepreneurship means is that you use a business model to help the community. Meaning that if there is a flood, you just don't go and you raise some money and you give the money to them, then you go back. It will not be sustainable. The next year the flood will come again. Then you have to raise some money and give them again. And the flood come again. You know? And you go and help the poor people by, you know, cleaning their house once a while. But then their house become, you know, worse again. So rather than doing that, which is not sustainable, you try to use a business model. How you use a business model, and to make sure that this is where people say that rather than giving a fish, you give them, teach them how to fish. And then there's more, you need to revolutionize the fishing industry and continue on. So a lot of young people are very interested in social entrepreneurship activities. And I would encourage those of you who feel that you want to make a difference to your society, think of social entrepreneurship programs and activities. You can suggest to the ministry, you know, and then we can work with you. And establishment of student cooperative. I'm not sure whether, do you have cooperative in Taylor's, students, owned by students? Do you know, if you look around, there are so many business opportunities in this campus. But why the university giving it to outside people? Why can't the university give the opportunity to you guys? It is a very captured market, you know. So I always challenge students, do a proposal, submit it to university, saying that why is Old Town is there? Why not you create your old town? And you are among yourself, you know. That is a policy. If you say no, see, you are go against the government policy. I'm giving you some. And of course, for us to make things happening, we need to work with industry people. We cannot say that, you know, like government knows the best, it's over. That's why we always work with banks, we work with MDEC, Multimedia Development Corporations, to come up with programs that is beneficial for students. In terms of the outcomes of the policy, after 2 or 3 years has been launched, we can see that it has contributed in terms of awareness, meaning that if we talk about entrepreneurship, it's not alien anymore to university students. They know that what is entrepreneurship is all about. It has also increased participation of students' activities in entrepreneurship activities and enhanced student readiness to venture into entrepreneurship as a career option. This is just to share with you the issues in students' entrepreneurship, more students' business. First is to balance between academic and business. We do have situations where the students purposely doesn't want to graduate. You know why? Because they have a business in the university. So the rule is that you can only do business in university when you are still students. When you graduate, you have to go out. So there are students very enterprising enough that they can get good money from doing business in universities. They purposely don't want to graduate early, you know. And we also don't want that if you are so involved in business, you forget about your academics. So you must know how to balance between your academics and your business. And how best can you guys contribute to the overall economic growth and nation building? What makes it different between graduate entrepreneurs and just small, medium enterprise out there? Just those people who just are selling using like the hawkers. What makes it different from graduate entrepreneurs? You guys have knowledge. You guys have network. You guys have credential. So you are the one who's supposed to involve in entrepreneurship activities, which is knowledge-based, which is technology-based, innovative-led, and which contributes to the job creations as well as the creation of wealth of the country. A lack of encouragement and supportive culture. There are also situations where students would very much want to become entrepreneurs, but this is more of Asian culture. In Asian culture, sometimes you will have to ask permission for your parents, right? Because they have invested so much money in you. Usually, if you ask your father say, ask your mother. You know, if your mother say yes, I will say yes. Yeah. It happens, I'm not sure, in other countries, but in Malaysia, it's still like that. So what if your mother say, your mother send you to Taylor's to become a doctor, and suddenly you tell your mother, you know, oh, I don't want to become a doctor. I just want to become a burger seller. And then what will your mother reaction? First, she will she fainted or she cried. The moment your mother cry, you know, like you have softy heart and says that, okay, mommy, I follow you. Okay? So, no entrepreneurship. Okay, I work with daddy. Why I work with mommy, okay? So we do have that lack of encouragement, you know? And same thing with friends, you know? Some friends say that, no, don't go into business, it's too risky. The situation is not good, you know? Just work with me. Work with me, work with him. Okay. Product marketing and networking issues, because usually when you are new, same thing with labor markets, you are new, you have less experience. The business out there, usually there are people who control certain market, there are people who control certain things, you know, so you have to really know how to overcome that issue. Sustainability and competitiveness. And number 7, in Malaysia, entrepreneurship has yet to be considered a career of choice. How many of you here actually, yes, I want to be my own boss, set up my own enterprise? How many dare to say that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 over 6. How many of them are in the class?
35.
So it's about 6 over 35. How many percent is that? How many percent is that?
17-18%.
Yeah, you know, not so many. Okay.
Higher than the national average, isn't it?
Higher than the national average.
Oh, that's good.
Okay, there is study, study done by the ministry only. Study.
Excuse me, there's a question.
Yes, sure.
I think you missed point number four, is it?
One second. Yeah.
Point number? Seven.
Four.
Oh, yeah, access to seed funding and capital. Sorry, I missed that point. I would go into that. I'll go into that because it's more of a mental block, Andrew. You know, when you want to start a business, you say, I don't have money. But actually, study has said that when you want to start a business, how much money you need? You need a million?
No.
No. On average, you know, how much Steve Jobs needs when he actually... On average, people needs about 3,000 just to start up. And in Malaysia, there are so many funds available for young entrepreneurs. It's whether you didn't know about it or you didn't care to find about it. You know, next end of this month, President Obama is coming to Malaysia to officiate what? Magic. Magic is for what? It's not like Disneyland magic, you know. It's for those of you who are interested to be involved in creative business, you know. And they provide a one-stop center where you can ask for the loans. You know, there are banks who actually give loans to fresh graduates where you don't have to have collateral. And again, where we did some studies, you know, how much actually students need? It's about 3,000, 5,000. You can easily get it. Crowdfunding. You can ask Prof. Mushtaq, 5,000, angel investor. Or you know, like I always said that, you know, like even if we for Malay culture, you know, we have duit raya, or Chinese, we have ampau, right? You go back ampau for all your aunties. 1%, 1,000. Already get 5,000. So easy. Because my kids try to use that strategy to me.
So that thing, can you get President Obama to address a MOOC when he comes in?
It's beyond my...
You have to try, because you are asking these people to try.
Okay, sure. Yeah. I will talk to... Because it's been controlled by Ministry of Finance, but
you
I will
just
talk
put a thought there, put a note there. Who knows? Maybe he will even give us a recorded message. But anything will do.
Yep, everything Malaysia boleh.
Yeah.
Malaysia can. So in terms of this is just to show that the statistics has been done by Global Entrepreneurship Monitor. Okay, this is a comparison in Asia Pacific and South Asia country. You can see that Malaysia is here. Malaysia is this one, the dark purple. Nascent entrepreneurship rate means that people who wants to establish business, the business is between 0 to 3 months. Okay, and new business ownership is between 3 months and 42 months. Okay. You can see the statistic. What can you see? You see Malaysia is here. Here, here, here. You can see that in terms of new business rate, we are the lowest among the countries in Asia Pacific. Right? So that the entrepreneurship has not yet become culture in Malaysia. Okay. In terms of new business ownership rate, we are the second lowest. As we can see that Philippines is quite high in terms of nascent entrepreneurship rate. New business ownership rates, Korea is quite high, 20.4%. And this is the total early stage entrepreneurial activity. So Malaysia is here. Korea is here. So we need to do something, definitely. This is in terms of attitudes and perception. Perceived opportunities, meaning that those respondents who said that, oh, they can see, you can see there is opportunities in my country to do business. So in that area, it's quite good. Malaysia is quite good, meaning that Malaysian population can see that there are lots of opportunities to do business in Malaysia. But perceived capabilities were going down. Perceived capabilities mean that you believe that you have the knowledge, you have the skills to do it. So we still have, we have yet to beat countries like Singapore and Indonesia and India. Okay, fear of failure. Fear of failure, we are not that bad, we are not that scared to try. But intention. Intention means that whether you have intention to start your own business in 3 years' time. Again, Malaysia is quite not that low, but it's not as compared to other countries. There are some other countries which is higher than Malaysia. And only about 18.4% in Malaysia that has intention to start their own business. Okay, opportunities. There are lots of problems in this world, right? As I said before, problems are opportunities to entrepreneurs. If there is no problems, there will be no chance for you to make money.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. You make money because there are problems. Right? For example, there are too many wires. Please solve these problems. Wireless. So these are opportunities for entrepreneurs. Global economy. Don't think about only selling something in Taylor's. Don't think about selling something in Sunway. It's globalized world, selling something online. You don't have to physically be present outside the country. You can use online mechanism, you know, online platform to sell your products. Huge niche market, which is too small for the big giant. What does it mean? That, you know, like, for example, like Coca-Cola, they're so big. They are only cater for big markets, but there are small markets that you can still go in. A very niche, specific products that only a few people are looking for it. So there are still market for that. And numerous support and incentive provided by the government for the young entrepreneurs. Again, I said, in Malaysia, if there are young people asking for something from the government, the government will try to fulfill that, you know, like when you said that, you know, like tweet to PM, Prime Minister, you say that we want this, we want that, you know, so we create magic. Because we know that lots of young people like to be involved in creative industry. And entrepreneurship is the ultimate meritocracy. It doesn't matter whether you come from rich country, rich family, or you come from the poor family, if you try your best, you will actually reap the benefits of your hard work. Okay, I would like to not finish early, but because I need to open up for more discussion with you guys, you know. So in conclusion, we can see that entrepreneurship education is very important for a country that wants to go forward, you know, because we want to encourage an innovative and enterprising society. For that to happen, we do need a supportive ecosystem, which is a very crucial factor. Not everyone can become entrepreneurs, but every one of you here should have an entrepreneurial mindset. You know, you should think like an entrepreneur. Doesn't matter whether when you graduate, you want to work in other companies, but you must have an entrepreneurial mindset for you to be successful and for you to be competitive as compared to your friends. In Malaysia, entrepreneurship education has become a policy. And has also become a critical agenda in Malaysian higher education sector. Okay, so again, we are in the process of coming up with a new blueprint, a new higher education blueprint. And one of the focus that we would like to look into is that how can we make our graduates more enterprising, more entrepreneurial? So we do need, you know, for us to. Sometimes we cannot think like, we may not be able to think like, what is it that you want? Because we are already out from the system, from the universities. So I would like to take this opportunity as those from the online, you know, students online, you know. What are the things that you can suggest to us, suggest to me, for us to make it a policy? When we make it a policy, you will get benefits from it. So I guess I open up for feedback and discussion.
Just want to ask, what was your aspiration when you were younger?
Wow, not so long ago.
Maybe just repeat the question because I don't think the people here have heard it. What was your aspiration when you were much, much younger?
Okay, I got a chance to further my study overseas because of I got a scholarship from the government. If I don't get scholarship from the government, I may not have the opportunity to go there, you know, and to learn so many, to be exposed to so many new things. So what I, at that time, I was saying to myself, since I've gained something from my country, I want to give back to my country. And I see there are lots of people who have potential, but they don't have opportunities. And what is the best way for me to contribute something is that I know that we can change a people's life through education. That's why I'm now in the Ministry of Education, you know, because I think that I can contribute back in terms of helping the people who may not be lucky enough to be born in rich family, you know, but they have the potential. But in Malaysia, every child has the rights to go to schools. So if you want to change that, you can do it through education system. So that's why I'm very happy to be here today, because I'm at the place where I can make a difference. And of course, for me to make a difference, I need suggestions, I need inputs, I need comments, I need people to correct me if I'm wrong, you know, because it may be good last 3 years, it may not be good now. So that, I hope that answers my question.
Hello. Okay, well, since you are talking about the government supporting entrepreneurship and such, why do we not see the government promoting it more? Like, you know, when I go to job fairs, every time I see all the companies, I never see the Ministry of Education there giving promotions on, oh, we have loan and funds and trainings for you to do entrepreneurship. That's why a lot of us, we probably don't know about it, because we just don't see it. If you put in a newspaper, we probably don't really read it a lot. Okay, I do see it on TV once in a while, here and there. But you know, that's about it, because then when I pop into a job fair, everyone is there, the Ministry of Education is not there, and then no one's telling me, okay, you know, we have support for entrepreneurs and such. I mean, only now we're hearing about that magic thing, but that's about it.
Thank you, because I think it's not that we are not doing it, but the way that we promote it may not be effective, as you said that you don't read newspapers. So maybe after this, we have to promote through Facebook. But I thought it's outdated already. my daughter said it's outdated already, mommy. You know, yeah, we will. Thank you so much. So we will. Actually, we do have. It's coming in September. There will be, we call it Entrepreneurship and Career Job Fair. It will be done, I think, because we need to wait for all of you to finish up, and then it's 27 to 29 September. Okay, I'll make sure that if that's happened, I'll ask Prof. Mushtaq to put it online or things like that, so you'll be aware. So at that fair, we will bring it. You must remember that the ministry cannot provide jobs, the ministry cannot provide the funding, but the ministry will bring in all those institutions who can provide you that with that opportunity. We did that last year in PWTC. In June, but again, I think because of the promotion, so we will definitely improve on that.
All right. Just two questions. The first question is actually, since we are learning the entrepreneurship, right? Maybe from the promotion part, like the guys say just now, maybe you can do something to the promotion. And I think that there's one major problem is that this. In as far as Malaysian, I believe that there's a lot of opportunity and there are a lot of potential people, but the main reason is not because of the education. It's, I think there are some problems with the system where the people who have potential and ability, they couldn't really grab the opportunity. It's not that they don't want to grab the opportunity, but they don't have the environment for them. But that's why the other countries, they are providing the same environment, but how can Ministry of Education in cooperation with other ministry to help in this environment.
Do you have any suggestion? How can the ministry?
Because I am not prepared for this, so I just asking.
Okay, you can write to me. You can write to me if you have suggestions. Because as I shared with you just now, one of the things that we are looking in at is that how can we provide a conducive environment for your entrepreneurial developments. And this is the time for you to give more and more suggestions. You know, for example, we are thinking about coming up with a green lane policy for students to bid for contracts, like for example service contract universities, so that, as I said, right, why giving it to outside people, why don't give to students, you know? But of course, you know, we need some we are saying that, oh, we are proposing this because this is what the students want. So the more you say that you want this, you want that, it's easier for us to actually make it happen. You know, we don't want to propose something that, and then later on we find out, oh, this is not what the students want. You know, because before we think that you need funding, so we come up with lots of fundings. You know, and then we just realize that, oh, students doesn't really need like 100,000 ringgit funding. They just need like SIT funding, like 5,000. You know, like 3,000. But if you don't tell us, we might not provide something which are you looking at. That's why, again, what is it that you think is the best for us to provide for you, to make it the environment conducive? As you said, we have lots of potentials. I'm sure there are lots of potentials in this class, but how to unleash that potential? And what can the governments do to assist? Or to support?
Actually, you spoke about the equal distribution of wealth, and actually I'd like to thank you about your speech today. And the thing is, if you're talking about entrepreneurs, if you have equal circulation of wealth among the entrepreneurs, do you think that will be beneficial within the entrepreneurial world in Malaysia?
If we can
circulate the wealth among the entrepreneurs, don't you think that will be beneficial?
Yeah, of course. You know, like we're always saying that we have a cake, we would like to distribute the cake equally as possible. One way for us to do that, you know, as I showed you just now, that the rate of people coming up with new business is quite slow in Malaysia. If that situation doesn't change, these big companies will always become bigger, bigger and bigger. So the wealth will only be in the hands of few people. But if there are always people who would challenge them, coming up with new products, coming up with new technology, coming up with new services, they will not control the market. So then it will be equally shared. So that, and definitely if we have more equitable society, then we will have more happy people, we have a better nation.
And more entrepreneurs.
And more entrepreneurs.
Thank you.
That's why I don't use millionaires, I don't use billionaires. That is not the ultimate aims, you know. Of course, we would like to see more of you become billionaires and millionaires, but we would like more and more of you to be entrepreneurs so that you can, in a way, make the economy more equitable, especially for those of you who are interested to become social entrepreneurs. Social entrepreneurs, their objective is not so much on profits, but so much in terms of how they can enhance the socio-economic status of the society.
So, there are no other questions.
Actually, I just want to say a few words. I want to acknowledge Datin Shahira for her effort. She really reached out, and she has been very supportive for our initiative from the very beginning. And I think that's really the attitude that we would like to see in the officials, especially in an important ministry like the Ministry of Education. I also would like to thank her for a very engaging talk. That was really, really good. Yeah, please. Yeah. At the same time, you know, while we have watched this, and this is going to be put on YouTube for people within the country and also outside to see, I've just noticed that maybe there is some communication gap, that if you know, the different governmental agencies are doing great work and a lot of effort and money is being put in these, and for some reason, a sample from Taylor's University, you know, they represent 12,000 students, they didn't hear about it. I think maybe there is an issue that we need to settle. And I just have a suggestion for that. And maybe what you could do, you could have a council, an unofficial council of students. And maybe you meet with them once a month. You just tell them, look, we are doing this, and we are going to announce it, maybe going through TV3, for example. And maybe they will tell you, look, we don't watch that. For example. And then maybe they will suggest to you a better way of reaching out. I think that way maybe we could, you know, bridge some of the gaps. There's another suggestion that I suggested to her, so I really would like to see what do you guys think. This is for both the MOOC on campus. Rafi, are you with us? Yeah, as well as the rest. So I actually asked her to have her team. So she has a gentleman with a master's degree, people with the first degree that are doing clerical work. And maybe together, they should join, they enroll in the MOOC, and then maybe take an entrepreneurial project and even run a possible crowdfunding campaign for. And it could be anything, including maybe reaching out to the students. So I think we really need to change the way we operate. We have to be entrepreneurial from, I believe, from the bottom to the top. So I give her that suggestion, and let's see what's going to happen after that. Yeah. So with this, I would like to thank you very much. Thank the students as well for the very engaging questions, and also thank Datin Shahira one more time. Thank you very much.